everybody. Welcome to Performance Anxiety. I'm your host, Mark. We are proud members of the Pantheon Podcast Network. And this episode is a really cool one. First of all, I've got my new mate, Spencer Cullum, co-hosting with me. But just as exciting is my guest, BJ Cole. BJ has played pedal steel on some of the most loved albums of all time. He's played with Elton John, Sting, T-Rex, Bjork, Gerry Rafferty, Robert Plant, Richard Ashcroft, and the Verve. And he and Spencer talk about how the role of pedal steel is changing even in Nashville. And they tell me the scariest moment on stage, and it's basically the same for both of them. And I'm pretty sure it's probably the same for most pedal steel players. At one point, we were even joined by Spencer's dogs. So follow Spencer and BJ on social media. Check out BJ's new album, Daydream Smile, and Spencer's new solo album, Spencer Cullum's Coin Collection. Follow us all on social media. Subscribe, rate, and review. It's a huge help. And don't forget ko-fi.com/performanceanxiety to buy us a cup of coffee if you like the episodes. Now let's slide right into this chat with Spencer Cullum and BJ Cole on Performance Anxiety.
I'm very proud to have been on your show, Performance Anxiety. That is correct. I'm BJ Cullum. I do have a new album, which is on a label called Cow Pie Twang, believe it or not. And it's a Hawaiian album, of all things, after talking about all my progressive exploits. It's called Daydream Smile, and it's on Cow Pie Twang. And it's coming out in November. And it's been great to talk to both of you and
yeah,
Spencer.
Yeah, it's good to see you again, BJ. Good to see you, Mark.
Thanks, buddy, to me. It's really lovely to talk to you. And I can't wait to get to Nashville again just as soon as possible.
Yes, there you go. When this is all over, we'll hang out in Nashville or vice versa. I'll come out to London.
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too. How you doing,
mate? Get rid of me. You just can't get rid of me.
I really get it.
Very nice to see both of you.
Oh, and, you
great.
Too.
Okay. Anyway, you've already had a session together.
Yes. Very indeed. Nice one. Yes.
Oh, good. Oh, hello. I'm trying to fiddle around with a light here just so you can see me better.
No worries.
There we go. There you go.
All right. So
it's the technology, right? Want some lurid stories.
You know, I'm dying for some.
I think it's trying to install an update or something. I worry about that.
Yeah, my phone did that last night. I was kind of worried about it because it tried once the day before and it failed. And it's like, we'll just try it again. I'm like, I know it's going to try doing it when I'm doing something really important like this. But fortunately, it decided to do it in the middle of the night and it was successful. So,
right.
But it decided to add an app to my phone without my knowledge and it shifted all my... Whoa! Oh my gosh, Spencer shifted too.
Sorry.
But it shifted all my apps over by one, so I had to go find everything. So I'm like, where the hell is my Skype app? I don't even know where the hell this crap is now. And it shifted over a page. So, but I would thank you guys, both of you guys, Spencer and BJ, for coming on. This is really cool. When Spencer said he knew you, I was like, I got to get you guys on because I've been a fan for a long time, not nearly as long as you've been recording, because as is the case with a lot of the session people that I've had, don't really realize who's on what albums. But I learned of you, BJ Cole, from the Richard Ashcroft solo album, along with everybody.
Great record.
And that was your pedal steel is so prominent on that album. I have a tendency to go read liner notes, and that's why I still love physical LPs and CDs. And I had to find out who was doing this incredible work, and it was you. So I've been going backwards ever since and trying to find the stuff that you've been on. So I'm really a thrill to have you on the podcast. Thank you.
It's great to be on the show. Thank you.
And then Spencer is a returning guest. So you're kind of like a returning guest / co-host today. I don't know what you're going to be.
Pressure's on now.
Yeah.
Pressure's on now. So, yeah.
Pressure's on. Okay. Ask me questions. Okay.
Let's go. Chop, chop. Yeah. All right. So I've already gone through this with Spencer. So I want to find out a little bit more from you, BJ, how you got into music in the first place. Was your family musically oriented, or was it you a black? Were you a black sheep?
I was a bit of a black sheep. Yeah. But my father was a very enthusiastic sort of amateur musician and fan of music, and he had a great collection of 78s of people like the Ink Spots and Phil Harris and Bing Crosby and good stuff, you know. So he obviously had a good taste in music, and when I showed signs of learning the guitar and then the pedal steel, he was totally supportive and used to drive me around to concert gigs and wow. All that sort of thing, you know. So he was brilliant. Yeah,
that's wonderful. Because I mean, I tend to hear the two extremes. They were either really supportive, or they didn't want me to have anything to do with it. So
I was very lucky.
So, what instrument did you start off with? Because I don't think you jumped right into pedal steel, did you?
No, I played guitar. I was one of the Hank Marvin boys. You know, I loved the Shadows.
Oh yeah.
Cliff and the Shadows when they came along, but you know, that was it. You know, there was a phenomenon in the UK, other than about not in the States so much, I don't think, with the Shadows, but right. You know, it was a social phenomenon that most schools had a Shadows group.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah, my schools had a Shadows group, and I got into guitar. I'm left-handed, so I naturally picked the guitar up left-handed.
I didn't know you was left-handed, BJ.
I am.
I am too, yeah.
Are too?
Yeah, yeah.
How extraordinary. As is Lloyd Green.
Lloyd Green is as well, yeah.
And Courtney Shawker, I believe. Yeah.
Was it okay? I always played right-handed because it just was cheaper, you know, just like to buy a right-handed guitar. There was no
How interesting, isn't it?
That's crazy.
Well, I gave up the guitar because I learned steel guitar. I intentionally went and learned pedal steel the correct way round because it's cheaper and possible to find pedal steel in 1964 or whenever it was. So I learned pedal steel or lap steel or whichever you wanted this first, and pretty much gave up guitar because I was playing it the other way around.
Ah, okay.
That's the reason I don't play guitar.
Ah, okay. And I'd imagine with that being so popular, there's probably a lot of guys playing guitar and you know, pedal steel is a unique sound, or even lap steel, it's a unique sound.
Yeah.
Did you start playing live, you know, with bands as a guitarist or as a pedal steel, lap steel guitar player?
Well, I didn't really play live much at all, actually. I played with a local group around North London, playing guitar, you know, in people's living rooms, you know, just to learn the songs and to write stuff. And I never really had an ambition to be a professional musician back then. I didn't even know it was possible.
Oh, really?
Probably just as well, because I would have concluded it would have been impossible to be a career, you know, in the UK in the early 60s. You know, it's not something you expect to be something that can sustain you for a whole lifetime. Now I look back and think, God, how did I do that?
So what did you...
Only because I just jumped into it, and it was the thing that grabbed me and said, you've got to do this. You know, it wasn't a rational financial, you know, line of work I thought I was going to do. In fact, I was going to be a photographer at the start.
Hey, there you go.
Yeah. I was going to be a photographer to start with.
I did that for about a dozen years.
Oh, yeah. Great.
So, all right. So I got a connection. That's fantastic.
Yeah. I could play David Bailey, you know.
There you go.
Well, he's one of my heroes. It was amazing.
So when did the session work start?
Oh, that was much later.
Oh, okay.
I'd played in country bands around London in the 60s and then got connected with a lot of people in the sharp end of the music business. That is the sort of rock and roll end of the music business. And I, after trying to get out of the country scene, as I was much more eager to take the pedal steel into, you know, rock and roll and psychedelia and the underground.
Okay.
What sort of country music was being played in England at that time, though, by English people?
It was a different circuit. In London, it was the West London Fuller's Pub circuit.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
And there were a lot of Irish bands on the Fuller's Pub circuit.
That makes sense.
And the Nashville room. Do you know the Nashville? It's on Cromwell Road in London.
Oh, okay.
West London. And they had all sorts of, they brought in American artists, but essentially they had an agent that created a circuit around all the Fuller's pubs in West London, and it was the place to go to play with bands, basically. And obviously by that point I'd become aware of country music. In fact, country music I wasn't aware of when I first learned steel guitar.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah.
No.
Was it more Hawaiian?
More Hawaiian to start with, and Santo and Johnny.
Oh, yeah.
I'm a massive. It was really Santo and Johnny that converted me from the guitar to the steel guitar. I still love that sound, and it's so unique. It's so unlike any other player playing steel guitar. Don't you think so, Spencer?
Oh yes.
Hawaiian. It's not really Hawaiian. It's sort of cod Hawaiian.
Yeah.
It's more like doo-wop records.
Yeah, especially like songs like "Summertime," where you hear like
brindin,
like that.
Got it.
You know.
probably one of the best ones.
There. Yes, there's only the famous record which I have, which was the main record, which has got all the hits on it. Yeah,
Sleepwalk. I've got all the albums and.
But I like that kind of that, and Jerry Bird was kind of like that straight sort of steel sort of six children was like,
yeah,
it was wonderful.
Yes, yeah. Well, it's right, and it's quite difficult to play.
It's really difficult to play.
I mean, I went to a teacher who taught in the BMG magazine, you know, the '60s BMG magazine. He advertised in there, a guy called Edward Kirkman. He lived in Canvey Island, in fact.
Oh, right. Okay.
He taught me all that stuff, and he nearly scared me off because it was really difficult. He had one of these diatonic tunings that you had to be careful what strings you picked and which ones you missed. And they were compound tunings, and you couldn't strum it, and it was difficult to articulate for, you know, chords.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
It's a very difficult style. You know, I was learning music as well. I was learning stuff from notes.
Oh, okay.
Nobody told me I couldn't do that or shouldn't do that.
So that was something I had wanted to ask Spencer. I didn't even think about the tunings on a pedal steel. I mean, first of all, how many strings? I know there's different styles, different types of pedal steels, but how is it set up, and what kind of tunings do you use for that?
How long you got?
How long's a piece of string? Yeah.
We're doing a whole podcast on just on pedal steel tunings.
Well, essentially, most people use an E9th tuning or a C6 tuning in Nashville and in country music, mostly. But there is another more complex, which they're usually 10-string tunings. They have 10-string on an instrument. And most players use a double neck. E9th on one bank and C6 on another bank. So you've got 10 strings and 10 strings. And there is more recently a universal tuning which has 12 strings, but just one neck. And that's what I use.
You know,
I'm dedicated to that. And even my tuning is not standard. I've changed it around.
I hear that from a lot of the best players in different instruments. Yeah. Like Fripp's got his own, you know, new standard tuning. And so.
Yeah.
So you like the Robert Fripp of pedal steel?
Yeah, I always back in when I first started, my hobby was inventing tunings.
Oh, really?
I spent most of my time when I wasn't playing inventing tunings.
Oh wow! So
I never settled on the standard that most people use.
Is your tunings? Are you still keep?
No, I got it right when I invented when I used this. I decided to stick with that because by that point I'd spent 15 years refining it. You know,
I always stuck with E9.
Yeah,
it was always so. I don't know. I found it so easy to move around on E9, and you know, it's kind of like.
Yeah.
And only recently, I'll show you it now. Only recently, I've gone to D10.
Oh yeah! Oh right.
And
okay.
It was always like
Judas.
E9 was like, it was, I sound so lazy here. It was like, I didn't have a left-handed steel because it's cheaper. Now E9 was lighter to sort of like carry around, you know. Yes. It was like this double.
But it doesn't go deep enough for me.
I know, and that's the problem. That's why I've started getting into C6.
Yeah.
And because, but that's, I've only been a month into it. Everyone called it over here. It's like, I've been doing E9 for years now, since I've been playing steel. And I've never had a situation where I've had to play C6 tune. And I guess the difference, Mark, is like E9, C6 is more jazz and western swing. That's what I think. Okay. But like,
well, that's the problem with a double neck, you see.
Yes, it is. Yes.
It's either one or the other, and therefore it rules out everything else.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, it doesn't blend the two.
No, they're not related to one another.
Oh,
no.
Wow, okay.
Whereas in the universal tuning, they relativize the C6 to B6, so it's diatonic against the E9.
Yes, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, I can remember having, I'll try and bastardize my way through like any sort of C6 style, you know, riffs or licks or anything. Yeah.
You can do it,
but it's usually like I try and like approach it as how like Tommy Tedesco would approach it. You know, like he's like a great guitarist, but he'll like have like five riffs in a certain style of music and use them well. With C6 on the E9,
most people like that.
Yeah, exactly.
There are many musicians that transcend the pocket thing, you know.
That's true, yeah.
That's a good point.
It's like, but I have about a year ago or something, someone was like, can you do it? It was like a very like a heavy sort of Western, sort of like a six style song that I had to play on. And I was like, I've got to kind of learn this. What do they call it over here? They call it the no money neck.
Well, that came out of the Curly Chalker thing, wasn't it? It's Curly Chalker, because he pushed the six tuning really hard in a quite bloody minded sort of way, you know.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And he suffered from it in Nashville.
He had a reputation for it as well.
Yes, so. That's right. He did that for Nashville. Yeah, so, but what a amazing player!
Oh my word, unbelievable! Yeah.
So, how did the two of you guys meet?
I went and saw you play at the Spitz, DJ, ages ago, and I...
Oh, did you? Right.
Kind of bad. You was doing something. It might have been with Luke Vibert or something like that.
Yeah,
and
it
was great.
Oh right, good.
But I can remember approaching you afterwards and saying like, "Hey, I'm learning. I'm trying to get through this thing, and it's a hurdle."
Yeah. Well, that was a very unusual thing to be going to see if you wanted to find.
Well, I really enjoyed it because it kind of made me be like, because I never grew up on country music. I grew up on pedal steel, rock and roll music.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah. Like, and then I saw you play this like electronic stuff with pedal steel, and I was like, "Whoa, it can be used for that. That's great. I don't have to learn this country music."
Yeah,
but I think you do. I think you have to. Some people kind of try and escape not learning the traditions of country music and pedal steel. I think, you know, and I think well, that's
all there was when I started. You know.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Now, in the practical sense, you know, obviously I'm aware of Santo and Johnny who weren't country. I was aware of Alvino Ray and all the early players, the great, you know, early players who to me are more modern in their thinking than a lot of the pedal steel players around now.
I think so too. Yeah.
Wow. Well, Murphy and people like that. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it was like technique and understanding the mechanisms of it. You know, it's like, it was like the forefront of it, I think. So.
So you ended up studying with BJ then?
He taught me, yeah. He kind of helped me.
Is that something that happens a lot? I mean, do you take on a lot of students after they approach you after a gig?
I'm not a very good teacher, actually. I can help people a lot. You know, actually, I'm not a very methodical one. I'd like to think I can teach well and I'm methodical and I help people, but I sort of overwhelm people, I think. I sort of give them everything in one go.
Well, I do remember one thing, like in the first lesson, because I was, the left hand, I'm still here now, where like your left hand, my left hand was so, you know, left and right. And I think the first thing you taught me was like, play, hold your bar more and go around and hold your bar. And could you use my, you know, the main thing was vibrato. Yeah, you know, it wasn't about, and like you showed me the Jimmy Day record, and I was like, "Listen to this. This is the record."
Yes,
you know, and that kind of like
it's still the record.
It's still the record. No knee levers as well.
That's bizarre. Right. I know. Yeah.
You know.
Okay. So, explain that for those of us who don't know a whole lot about pedal steel. What do the knee levers do? How do they work?
How long you got?
Podcast number two.
Well, they do similar things to the pedals, really. Yeah. They do similar things to the pedals, but you combine them with what you're doing with your feet on the pedals, and you create thousands of combinations of changes to your open tuning, as opposed to tens or maybe 100 by just having your foot pressing on pedal 1, pedal 1 and 2, pedal 2, pedal 2 and 3. You're limited with just pedals. Right. If you've got levers, whichever phrase you use,
levers.
You're multiplying exponentially the possibilities, because the pedals and the levers do similar things. Not the same things, but complementary things. So you're changing your tuning as you're playing in thousands of subtle ways.
Okay.
I don't think there is an instrument like that.
No, there is.
You know,
I can't think of anything like that.
And as I said once before, because that's the nature of the instrument, a pedal steel, that is, you can slide up and down strings, and you can change the internal voicing of the chord at the same time in pitch bend. You can't do that with any one instrument, one player instrument.
Right, yeah,
You do it with a choir, you can do it with a string quartet, but you can't do it. No one player can play any other instrument and do that,
right.
Not naturally. You can force a guitar to do that, but it's not natural to it.
Yeah. It feels like, especially with you doing classical music on it, you know, you can almost, it's so orchestral.
Yes.
The guitar, you know.
It is. You get such a dense sound from a single instrument. I think, and I've been listening to some of the classical interpretations you've been doing, and Spencer just dropped out. Hopefully he'll come back, but but it really
there it is.
There we go. So I keep cutting out.
Oh, no worries. So we're just saying that I think a pedal steel is wonderfully suited for what BJ is doing with his interpretations on classical music, because it's so dense. You don't need so many people doing so many different things, because you can emulate a lot of different instruments all at the same time.
Yeah, sort of.
You can bring something new to the various sorts of classical music as well.
Yeah.
You know, I work with this cellist who's a tremendous player, and cello and pedal steel together are virtually a small orchestra in them between the two of them.
I think, like, especially with steel and strings, that Jimmy Day record we were talking about, the pedal steel and strings is unbelievable. I love recording music with strings, pedal steel with strings.
Yes, you work a lot of your stuff on steel is like that.
Yeah.
Love those records.
So was Spencer a good student?
I think so. He's now a bit more naive, you know.
All right, so we got a little bit of history here, but how did the session work start? What was your first pro session?
Well, I could say it was Elton John's Tiny Dancer, really. For all intents and purposes, it's the record that gave me a career in session work. Oh, I feel so real, lying here with no one near, only you.
Madman Across the Water.
I did
album.
Sessions before that. I did a session for Albert Lee before that.
Oh, really?
On his very first solo album that never got released at the time.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yes, it's out now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Black Plore and Country Fever.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that came out in the early 90s, right?
Yes, but it was recorded in 68.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. He sang on it, which I think he was very down on himself for singing on it, because he'd not sung before.
Oh, okay.
Why, it was a label called Bell Records.
So, that album exploded. That song in particular just exploded. Did you get, were you starting to get requests for session work immediately after that, or was it?
Pretty much. I didn't, you know, I as one does, when you're sort of a bit inexperienced, you do a session like that. You know, I happen to know him and the people at Dick James Music he was connected with very well. So they just rang me and said, come in. And it was all mates, basically, at Trident Studios. We spent the entire night working on that track.
Wow.
Which was fantastic. Coming out at 6 in the morning, and we cut the tiny dancer, you know, without strings. And he probably redid the lead vocal and the strings and the backing vocals. The rest of it was, you know, all went down in one go.
That's great. Amazing.
I always like how that song, the chords are really suited for steel as well. Yeah, maybe because he's a piano player. It's like a good. Yeah. I always struggle whenever, like, I love playing songs when the chords are like really move well with steel guitar.
Well, there's more distinctions on that song than in any other pop song. So it goes through different changes, different sections, doesn't it? It's almost like we're there all night, and I think we thought a bit too hard, you know, and said, where can we go now? You know, we'll take a left turn here and go off in that direction.
Yeah.
It was a bit like that, actually. Sort of chipping in.
Brilliant, yeah. That's but great.
That song was actually written with the pedal steel in mind, though, right?
I was there while it was being put together, yes.
Okay.
Pretty much, and it's the only pop song where this pedal steel is virtually audible all the way through.
Do you find when you're doing session work that, especially after that, I guess maybe are the songs crafted for pedal steel, or are they just trying to, do you have to help the songwriters fit the pedal steel in?
Since every shade of one end to the opposite end, set of possibilities. Yeah. Basically, you know, I've been done infinite numbers of sessions where people want to use me to make it more country. I've done infinite number of sessions where people have wanted to make it more left field and not country, because people know me for doing that.
Right.
You know, taking steel away from what is conventional.
Yeah, and that's one of the cool things is some of the people you've worked with. I mean, some of them, I can, you know, you hear who they are and you think I can hear a pedal steel with them. You know, obviously Elton John. You've got the incredibly popular tracks of Gerry Rafferty. Verve's Urban Hymns, but then you even Roy Harper, but you've got some other artists that you've worked with where I'm like, pedal steel's in here, like Bjork and Alan Parsons, and I'm, you know, when I think of Alan Parsons and prog rock, I don't really think of pedal steel, and so now I'm paying more attention to it.
That stuff. I did a lot of heavy rock stuff in the early 70s. I played with Humble Pie, 3 albums.
Yes, I saw that.
Stops and starts to make a crime. He said, son, I'm afraid I must. just must waste your time.
Steve Marriott, you know, he was, whoa, what a guy. You know, I was one of my great heroes. You know, to fight yourself in Olympic Studio One in 1970 with Steve Marriott and Humble Pie with Glyn Johns at the controls.
Oh,
and
wow.
And you go, I think I've made it now. I think I'm where I want to be.
Yeah. I've given up on being a photographer.
Managed to escape from the country scene.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I've got those. That's a lovely memory, that remember having that realization in probably one of the best rooms that was ever recording studio in London. Just working with Steve Marriott and people like that. Yeah. Amazing.
We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors.
Do you really like the, I've been listening, you were saying that you were playing rock out like bands back then. There's a record that I found recently called Trapeze.
Oh, yeah.
And it's really, it's like...
Oh, that's an amazing record. That was even earlier, I think. That was about
60, yeah.
It's a great record.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's called Coast to Coast, was it?
Coast to Coast, that's it, yeah.
Brilliant record. It's one of my favourite things that I've done. So I did loads of heavy rock stuff.
There's harmonized big guitar sounds that should like be like Deep Purple with the pedal steel just going across it. Kind of
I seem to do a lot of it. You know, that was, I was encouraging it. And people seem to like the idea of having a pedal steel. All you've got to do is stick it through a few effects boxes.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. It's better than a guitar.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, you work with Roger Daltrey.
Yes, that first Roger Daltrey album.
I mean, is there, you ever look back at like some of these songs that get played over and over and over again that they're not classics and just think, holy shit, I'm on that? Like the Gerry Rafferty. I mean, Gerry Rafferty stuff gets played over here, Baker Street and right down the line. Classic rock staples.
Not on Baker Street, but then that wasn't the single in the US, was it? It was Right Down the Line.
Yeah.
I think. Yeah,
exactly.
Which I am on. Yeah, that's a good record. And do you know No Regrets, the Walker Brothers?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yes.
I'm on that. They just kept the pedal steel at the beginning and at the end.
Oh, no. T-Rex, zinc alloy.
Now that's a funny story.
I want to hear that.
I don't even remember that session. And I don't even remember Mark Bolan being there. I remember Tony Visconti being there.
Oh, my gosh.
Not Mark Bolan. I can't guarantee that he was there. And if he was, he was probably asleep on the sofa.
Right.
It was an overdub. I did too many overdubs in around about 74, 75. I didn't really play with a live band much. Although I did play with Andy Fairweatherlow, who I have to say was fantastic. What a great really? Guy he was. He still is.
Yes.
Still.
He's
amazing. And I worked with his band. Played on Wide Eyed and Legless.
Was there a lot of stuff where it was like, you know, you kind of work with the producer and not the artist? I've kind of done stuff, and it's like, and then people say, "Oh, you've been on Dolly Parton's worked with Dolly Parton." I was like, "No, I don't." What's she like? And I'm like, "I have no idea." I've never met her.
That's what happens. When you went into a studio and recorded with people, you know, not that I do that much, especially at the moment, you know, that's any sign of a small amount of that happening is long gone now.
Yeah.
Real pity. And you're in the town for it.
Well, I am enjoying, it is nice to be at home overdubbing. I do enjoy that. I do get annoyed with Nashville being too, it gets a bit fast. You know, no one thinks about tracking, well, has time to think about the track. Everyone wants to go quick, we'll do this, we've got to do four songs in an hour or whatnot, and everyone kind of becomes like a plug-in. And it kind of, you know, it kind of sucks the life out of music.
It's like a factory.
Because that's how they've always done it, but the emphasis has changed.
The emphasis has changed, yes.
So it's like factory work.
Yeah, but people always did records really quickly, like they did in London back in the 50s, you know.
Yeah, I guess so.
They were the players in Nashville, the best players in Nashville, are extremely good at coming up with immaculate stuff on the spur of the moment.
Yeah, especially like Lloyd Green stuff. You hear some of his stuff and it's like, and then the amount of sessions he was doing a day.
Yeah. But all of those guys, you know.
Yeah.
Emmons,
yeah.
All of them.
Emmons, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's scary. Well, they're the people that we venerate, you know. I certainly do, you know.
I'm
in awe of those people and the skill they had to come up with goods quickly.
Yeah.
As I think it's fantastic.
In the session work that you've done, and taking Elton John's Tiny Dancer out of the equation, because I'm sure you felt this when you were recording this, have you ever been in a session and knew it was good, but knew, hey, this is going to be huge, this is going to be an enormous hit, because you've played on a lot of big hits?
I don't tend to think like that.
Okay.
I don't tend to think, you know, this is a stone cold certainty, because there's no guarantee to do that anyway, you know.
I was going to ask the flip side of that too, but I guess it's the same answer.
Working with legends is different, you know. I worked with John Cale for a long time.
Wow.
In the 90s. I toured with him. Didn't record much with him, but I toured with him in Europe and in the States, and that was fantastic. I did some very wacky, you know, things where I'd pinch myself. It was there, you know, just fantastic. Yeah. We did the what was it? Some concert. Don was MDing in Memphis.
Oh, wow.
In the Pyramid Conference.
Oh, yeah. Which is now a fishing shop.
Is it really? So it's not a concert hall anymore. Oh right.
No.
Anyway, we played it there, and they had all sorts of bands in a 3-day event to celebrate Elvis. Yeah, you know,
that was cool.
So they did their everybody did their version of an Elvis song, right?
Oh, cool.
And they had Jerry Lee. This was in 95, so Jerry Lee was there, Carl Perkins was there, everybody was there basically. And Don Was, who was a big fan of John Cale, realized he'd done a version of Heartbreak Hotel. Have you heard John Cale's version of Heartbreak Hotel?
I've heard that.
I don't know if I have.
Can you imagine what it was like playing for a bunch of Southern rockers?
Yeah, that's funny.
It's John Cale. John's version of Heartbreak Hotel. Can you imagine?
It's almost like an art piece.
But it's in a minor key, and it suits the lyric. It suits it's much better than, you know, the official version.
Wow.
So it's a minor. Yeah, it's like a minor.
Yeah. That's right. With a funny old chord in it as well.
Yeah.
Anyway, we were asked to play a set there featuring this John version of Heartbreak Hotel. And John, he was at the side of the stage going, "This is going to set the cat amongst the pigeons." So we played it, and there was this sort of stunned silence. Sort of edged off stage quickly before they pitched us.
What do I always say? And the crowd go mild. So.
Yes.
It was very funny. But
that's brilliant.
Also slightly scary.
Oh, God.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's fantastic. I love that version of it. I think that's great.
Well, exactly. Yeah, but to play it to a bunch of, you know, Elvis fans.
Yeah.
That was very fun.
Do many of
the string quartet as well, you know.
Really, oh wow.
Really
avant-garde string quartet scraping and squeaking and making funny noises. From New York. You know.
Oh man. Do many of the sessions become touring opportunities later on?
Not that many. Okay. Working with Sting I did.
Right. I saw
the Verve.
Yeah. And I wanted to ask you about that because they're one of my favorite bands of all time. And I know they implemented pedal steel on Urban Hymns. And I just kind of want to know how
no pedal steel on Urban Hymns.
There's not?
Oh, well, sorry. No, there isn't.
Oh my God. Okay, so there must be just slide guitar on like Velvet Morning and
Nick, the guitarist.
Wow.
Was a school friend of Richard Ashcroft, and they fell out in a huge way.
Yeah, many times.
And I never quite fully understood why they asked me to play steel with the Verve. You know, it's not the most obvious thing
right.
to have a pedal steel. It's getting me down, my love, like a cat in a bag, waiting to drown. This time I'm coming down, and I hope you're thinking of me. Is you laid down on your side? I've not really heard them.
Oh, really?
I wasn't really totally. I knew their name, but I wasn't totally aware of the, you know, when I what I'd heard, I liked, but I wasn't. It wasn't something that I naturally would have thought. Wow, that's a, you know, that's something.
So, what period of time was this? Was this after? Was this the Urban Hymns version? Was this fourth? Which album?
Tour? Well, it was after that. It was. They hadn't done a US tour.
Okay.
Up until that point.
Wow.
And we did the US tour, you know, after Nick had left.
Yeah. Oh, man.
He got it to do the US tour. And it was money, no object. It was that they were throwing everything at it.
God.
Fantastic. It was one of my more extreme rock and roll moments. I can see you. Now you can stand up, Spencer.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. I'm leaning this on one of my wife's pottery. So, like,
I see.
The makeshift. So I'm like, every time
have,
it starts,
have a proper little tripod for your.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I'm living on the edge a little bit. So.
Okay. Yes. Nice place. I look forward to coming to visit it.
I've still got that Pete Drake record in the vinyl behind me.
Uh oh.
Of course. No, my estimation and admiration for Pete Drake keeps growing the more I find out about him. Actually, amazing.
I do too. Yeah, mine too. Yeah.
He seems to have been a bit of a wheeler and dealer in Nashville, and in a good way. You know, because he had a studio, didn't he? And he did lots of good stuff.
Yeah, and he kind of is like, I don't know if he's underappreciated, but he kind of, you know, he's.
I think he is.
Yeah, especially in the steel community, because he was like, his phrasing is so like beautiful and like, you know, and it's kind of. It's hard to manipulate, I think, his phrasing. It's like, and there was this, there's the saying of, what was the, there's a Pete Drake story where Buddy Emmons and him were in the same room.
Yeah.
And Buddy Emmons like had his C6 neck and was just like, hey, Pete, can you do this? And went, bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a-bit-a player that was a well-known producer and then took out a roll of $100 bills and said, you sound like this.
I don't, you know, things, some of the things Buddy said about him, you know, are partly why he's under-respected, I think. A great pity, because it was unnecessary. Unfortunately, Buddy had a rather dry sense of humour.
He was a little salty, apparently.
Generally. He was quite to get sometimes, you know. He had that dry southern sense of humour.
One of the things that I like to find out is, everybody hears about great tours and all, but I kind of like to hear when everything kind of hits the fan. And I'll give you a great example. I had Trey Gunn on quite a while ago, and he was doing a solo show, And he's got a pedal board set up where he'll play a piece and record it, and it'll just keep looping, and he'll just keep building a song piece by piece.
Yes.
And he had one occasion where he was playing, and he started to build the song up. I think it was the song Arrakis off one of his early solo albums. And as he's playing it, it's sounding perfect in his earpiece, but none of it's getting out to the audience. And so he's sitting there playing like a 20-second piece and then stops playing, and the audience just sees him not doing anything. And then he'll come in and play another 10 seconds and then stop playing. And so the audience is just hearing what he's doing live. They're not hearing any of the loops, and he had no idea what was going on.
Right. So was he monitoring how he thought it was sounding?
Yes.
In his headphones? Right.
Yes.
But it wasn't getting out into the PA.
No. He was playing with two other guys, and this was his solo piece for the show. And they're just sitting out on the stage going, either something's wrong or he's just playing on a whole nother level at this point, but they didn't know which one it was.
Yeah.
Have you guys had any, both of you, have you ever had any like complete disasters on stage?
I'll have to think about that.
Yeah.
I think one of them was I did the Montreux Festival with Sting, and I suddenly realized at the last moment that I'd forgotten my bar.
I've done that a few times.
Really?
What do you do in that case?
I run around and look for a bit of metal. Oh. Anything.
I've used an SM57.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Microphone. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, sounded bloody horrible. In here. Yeah.
Oh, well, of course it would do, because it's not what you want it to be, is it?
No, yeah, yeah. I think after that, I always would carry bars. I'd put bars in the back of amplifiers or in random spots.
Yes,
you know, just the
exactly.
All right, yeah. So speaking of playing live, is the pedal steel kind of a pain in the ass to tour with? Because it seems to be very cumbersome, and you've got, is it hard to set up and break down and take on tour with you?
Depends on what level you're touring, really. You know, I don't tend to do big tours like I'm sure you've done, Spencer. Last couple of years, I don't tour for months at all. I'm not really a touring player in that sense. You know, there is no real world for a touring pedal steel player much in outside the US.
I think it's diminishing in America as well. The more country stuff I tour with, the less steel playing I see. Because country music is, it's turning. I mean, like now, it's kind of, you get pedal steel is kind of used. There's so many backing tracks now with live country music that if they use pedal steel, like, you know, there's like country music with like pop hip hop sound, which is not my cup of tea.
Me either.
And then they'll put the pedal steel in the bridge, and it'll just be on that. And then they'll just play it on a backing track.
So they'll just hit it with a trigger.
Yeah, it'll be very simple, sort of mashing the pedal sort of figure as well. Usually,
I've had
a few of those sort of country sort of rap records
Well, they'll put it on the bridge, and they'll be like, oh, because that's on the bridge, now it can go into the country music charts, you know.
Yeah, sort of. Exactly. I've heard a few of that. I quite like some of that stuff, you know, but
some of it's hard to explore. Yeah.
Yeah. But that's what makes a pop record, yeah.
I guess so, yeah. Some of it's a little, you know, derivative of, like, you know, pickup truck, you know, beers, you know, kind of like, you know, so, but, And the more I tour in that, the less pedal steel players I see, like, out on tour on big country circuit sort of stuff. So,
yes.
Oh man, that's a shame.
I see it more in Americana sort of bands, you know, like, which I'm sure you play with when they come over to Europe. You know, that's like, you know, or like,
I don't do that. Well, you were doing that.
I guess so. Yeah. I see more Americana sort of bands use pedal steel.
I'm sort of the man who they call on to use pedal steel in a different context. Out of the box.
And you've been doing that for a while. You've done a lot of.
I've been drawing it to me. That's what I always love doing. You know, I find myself taking the pedal steel into other places. You know, when I did an album called Transparent Music back in 89, 90, was on Ryko Disc. people started hearing it, you know, I was doing a bit of music journalism as well, so I was like spreading the word about the fact I'd done Sati and Debussy and things like that, the classical stuff and the and ambient stuff, because I just thought it was, the pedal steel was so perfect for it in when I was doing that in the 80s. And then producers who happened to like the pedal steel but would never be working in the area of went, oh, that's interesting, you know, and I started to get bookings from, you know, and connections with Brian Eno and Daniel Lanois. I know Dan plays steel guitar as well. I mean, he's another example of where it can go, you know.
Yeah.
But I found, and then I got the connection with John Cale, which came through Joe Boyd and Brian Eno, and they all introduced me to John Cale, and I
Cale! There's a wild dog next to me. They're Brian Eno fans, so when you mentioned them, they started going
So it was a feedback situation, you know, because I expressed my preference to take the pedal steel much in a much broader way. I started to pick up the fact that a lot of these producers and artists that just liked, were into sonics in a broader sense, were big fans of the pedal steel already.
Okay.
So I got my work in that area started to build.
And you've done some incredible stuff with Emily Burridge. I've been listening to that over the past couple of days, and the two of you together are just amazing.
We've been playing together for about 15 years, and it takes that long for it to be that tight.
I'm sure, yeah.
It's hard to do.
Yeah.
You know, there's no fronts, you know. No frets. You've got to pitch and articulate perfectly to make it work. And it takes a long time to get that together, you know. We've got a good repertoire.
Oh, yeah.
We're not doing so much at the moment because obviously we're locked down and she lives in another part of the country. But, you know, I'm sure we'll be getting to doing more of that.
I did hear something really weird yesterday, in fact, as I was listening to some music. You did a piece with Pulomi on prepared sitar.
Oh, my goodness. Yes.
That was insane. I was so fascinated by that thing. I've never heard an experimental piece with pedal steel like that. Was that all improvised, or did you guys work that out a little bit ahead of time?
It was free-form improvisation.
Wow.
And she treated this sitar and filled it full of electronics.
Oh, that's cool.
This Indian girl.
It's crazy. You know,
and with all the resonant strings and everything and full of electronics, effects going through effects. And we played, did a gig at the Cafe Otto.
Yes.
Which is the gig for free improv.
Yeah.
I was listening to it while I was at work.
It's amazing.
It is. It's incredible. But I'm I'm not really watching the video. I'm doing my job while I'm listening. And at like the 8.5 minute mark, the sitar started to sound like a donkey or something. So I had to like make sure I was still watching the same video. I was like, what the hell is going on? But it was. Yeah. And then... Yeah. And then I go back to my...
Steel's a great experimental instrument, you know. It's a great experimental instrument. I mean, David Toop, he introduced me to Luke Weber. This guy, David Toop, he wrote books about ambient music and stuff.
Oh, wow.
He was a friend of mine. And he introduced me to Luke Weber, and I ended up doing that album with Luke Weber, which I recommend. It's one of the best things I've done. That's a good record.
Well, tell the other weird thing about that video...
Stop the panic.
That's a great record. Yeah.
So the other weird thing about that video is that like the 19 minute mark or so, because it's a good long piece. It looks like she takes out an angle grinder or something onto the history. I don't know what she's doing. It's got something.
She was a little out there. Yes.
Yes. But it was so fascinating to listen to.
It was just a gig, you know.
Well, it was perfect for Halloween.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that Finnish player, Olli Haavisto, was there at the time.
Okay.
Do you know Olli Haavisto?
I don't know.
He plays with Eric Bibb.
Oh, okay. I know.
Nice guy. Really good player. Nice. He plays lap steel and all the different sorts of steel guitars.
Have you guys ever recorded together?
Well, me and Spencer?
Yeah.
Okay. No. We haven't yet.
Oh,
no.
Man.
Yeah.
Well, funny thing.
There you go. We better get that.
There you go. Yeah,
I saw somewhere online that there's this really awesome pedal steel player who you can send an MP3 to, and he'll edit it and he'll put his own parts on there. I think his name's BJ Cole.
I've been doing it a while now. Yeah. All that stuff. Yeah.
So you can do kind of like an online session. That's pretty cool.
I've been doing online sessions for 15 years. I just did an album for a band in Australia, actually.
Really?
Pretty much their record. The first time I've done one at that distance. Not that it makes any difference, you know, how far away it is. But that was quite interesting. The weird thing is how different people's heads are, you know.
Oh, I bet, you know, yeah.
That, culturally, you know. Not actually the reality of doing it. Yeah. It makes no difference, of course.
Do either of you guys remember any weird session? Because especially you've done session work. Do you have any weird, odd session things? Like maybe somebody you didn't expect to want a pedal steel calls you up and says, hey, come in and play something, or just...
Probably. I can't think of anything at the moment.
Well, that's, okay, that's a dumb question. Never mind. We'll edit that out.
Yeah, I was really enjoying the Matt Berry record.
Oh, you like?
I was listening to that yesterday, too.
I was going to mention that. What? It's a good record, isn't it?
Yes.
It's brilliant. Then I guess I'm gone. I better lay it on. Ghostly sounds in my home. They're watching me when I'm alone. I have no fear. I know they're here. I know it's you. Had the best come and been and gone. Well, the rest just keep hanging.
I love him.
He's a comedian, but his music is so good.
Yeah,
he can really take it serious. His music is serious.
Completely.
Is he the guy that's on What We Do in the Shadows?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I thought he looked familiar.
He's fantastic. Like the Verve, I'd never really come across him when he called me. Or the guys from Acid Jazz called, because that's the label he's on.
Okay.
And they said, oh, well, we've got this session, you know, can you come down to the studio and work on this? And then it became obvious because the lockdown was just about starting at that point. We had to naturally do it online, which I was quite happy about anyway.
Yeah.
He just sent me one track at a time just to see how it would go. He said, can you come and play on this? I've made a country album, which is not...
it's not a country record, no.
No, it's not a country.
No.
It's not even more country because I'm on it.
No, exactly. I like the fact that he would think it's a country record, but it's just a 60s pop record.
It's a sort of I wouldn't like to describe it, actually. It's really hard to describe it, but he's really good, and he really writes well, you know. And I was totally chuffed with what I did on it. It was just one of those things where he kept sticking them up and I kept on knocking them down, and he was just saying, oh, this is taking this to a different level, you know. And I was just, wow, what a nice thing for somebody to say.
It's really cool. And the production on it is fantastic. It's like,
that's just him. He's just put it together.
It really is, yeah.
It's not unusual to hear that about your playing, because that's exactly what I thought when I first really started hearing you on Richard Ashcroft's solo album, which, like I said earlier, that's my first time I really paid attention to the pedal steel on a pop type of album, and I had to find out who it was. So you're playing on that album defines that album, and that is one of my favorite albums of all time.
The Richard Ashcroft album.
Yeah, Alone with Everybody. It's
That's a great record.
It's incredible. And all the B-sides too, like Country Thing, City Thing, Blues Thing, you're playing on that is just... Mama, you're real fine. God, I can't. I'm kind of at a loss for words because it's funny because I go back to that album all the time. I mean, that album is what, almost 20 years old at this point, and I constantly go back.
The 90s were very good for me, actually. The 90s were one of my, the 70s and the 90s were my, you know, the time when I.
It seems like the 90s, there was loads of, a lot of good bands, English bands coming out then. It was Spiritualized. And,
You work with Spiritualized too. That's right.
Well, that was why I ended up working with the Verve. Richard's girlfriend was Jason's girlfriend. And it probably all came along the connections. You know somebody like, you know, who's a bit different, who we can use instead of a guitar player, you know. And
There's your guy.
Richard's girlfriend, you know, said, "Oh, I know somebody," you know, it was like that. You know, I had no idea at the time that that was the case. And I worked on Sting's, the first album I worked on Sting's record, it was largely, well, we were saying about, you know, my experiments with ambient music, reconnecting with, you know, with artists. And I'd done an album called Heart of a Moment, which was of my favorite ambient records that I've done in 95, which I did myself. And Sting apparently was doing yoga to it.
Oh, wow.
That's great.
So he told me. Because it had been released on a label run by a guy from County Durham, which was, you know, a local for him and his connection to Newcastle.
So you just never know where your next work is going
to
come from.
That's right. And so that was why he took me in. He liked people. He liked to have all the musicians working in his band who had their own thing going.
Do you think that, like, when you were, because I always, it's nice to get to a stage, I feel like I'm at, it's nice at a stage where I'm not a country steel, but I don't think much, but it feels like, and I hate being called in for a pedal steel player. You know, it's so much nicer to be called in to be like, I know what Spencer does and I'm using him because this is what, and I feel like at the beginning, like right from the get-go of your career, you've been called in because you sound like BJ Cole. That's your sound.
Yeah.
Instead of like, I want you to sound like a pedal steel. You know what I mean? Like, this is the sound. So it's kind of like, it's a nice kind of.
It's true. I can, if you start paying attention, you can pick BJ out.
I never could cut it playing the traditional licks. I tried very hard to learn the licks, and I can play. I could play them, articulate them, but they never sounded right. Tried to do the Curly Chalker thing, and I tried to do the Buddy Ellis thing, the Jimmy Day thing, and I go, "Wow, these guys are just, I'm in awe of these people. I can't do that." So it turned out that I had an approach and a sound that was better in a more contemporary setting, which is lucky for me.
Yeah.
You know, and I think the Elton John record defined it.
Yeah.
Have you come across that YouTube clip?
Oh, it's just the steel up in the mix, ain't it?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Brilliant. Yeah.
I will have to look that up.
It's the whole thing.
Yeah.
The whole part.
Oh,
which they recorded, you know, from beginning to end. And just faded it out and brought the strings in or brought the guitar in. And I was playing all the way through it.
That's great.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm going to look for that.
I hear it in the background, you know, so you can actually hear what I was trying to do.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. This is amazing. To find this after all these years, you know, to come across that.
Well, I love that. I was listening to that recently.
I didn't realize it existed.
I've got a split. Guys,
we'll wrap it up here. Thank you guys so much, both of you, for joining me. This has been a blast.
I'm very proud to have been on your show, Performance Anxiety.